this morning, man. He ministered the word beautifully. And I know you're not going to be disappointed tonight. So, Brother Steve, come and share with us.
Thank you very much. Almost feel guilty just to enjoy God's presence and just sing and just relish in His presence. Hallelujah. So, and I love the way it's totally different than this morning. You know, church, the sad thing is we all get in such a rut and we don't realize God's creative. He can always have something fresh for us to experience and so forth. So, have you ever asked the Lord a question? One time I asked the Lord, why did Jesus have to be born in a manger? And here's the answer I got. Every time I'm born in a human heart, I'm born in a filthy place. Because you think about that. Here's the Son of God, coming into the world in a filthy manger. But every time He comes into a life, it's in a filthy place. One time I asked the Lord, why did Apostle Paul have to live in prison? Why did he have to spend so much time in prison? And, you know, the Holy Spirit is so smart, but He said, He showed me this, if Paul would not have been in prison, he would have probably been busy, distracted, on his cell phone all the time, praying for people here, praying for people that. But he was locked up, and he had nothing to do but write letters. If he'd been out of prison, he probably would have influenced a few hundred people, maybe a few thousand people, but because he was in prison, his letters have reached billions of people. So God knows what He's doing. And so, it's fun to just fellowship with the Holy Spirit. I encourage you to do in your own home what we were doing here tonight. Just get in the presence of the Lord, talk to Him, sing to Him. I had a experience a number of months ago, but I was kind of complaining because I ran into this guy I hadn't seen for 30 years, and 30 years ago, his little boy and my little boy were 5 years old, and they were like little buddies. And I hadn't seen this guy. He's in full-time ministry. I hadn't seen him for 30 years. How you doing, Ray? How you doing? And we got talking a few minutes. I said, how's your son? And he tells me, oh, my son is, he's a president of this, and he's accomplished this. He's won 3 Nobel Peace Prizes. And, you know, he just goes on and on and on about his son. And then he walked away and never asked me one thing about my son. And I just couldn't believe how selfish that was, how self-centered. And, you know, even a sinner would have it reciprocate, you know. But then I got praying about it, and it's like the Lord said, this is what you do to me. You come into my presence and you talk about you the whole time. And so the Lord has told me when I pray that before I'm allowed to pray for me, I'm to ask Him who's on His mind. Which one of your kids are you thinking about this morning? Lord, what person is on your mind? What person is on your heart? And so for the past several months, every morning, I'm asking the Lord, and for about 15, 20, 30 minutes, He'll show me people to pray for. People I wouldn't have thought of. And it's just a blast because it's coming by the Spirit, because I know I'm not smart enough, and all these names are coming, and situations, and countries, and so forth. And just it's just fun. And then after that, I get to pray for good old Steve, you know, which is very important. But you know what I'm saying. It's just fun to just put the Lord first. We're all in a growing process, right? We're growing, we're learning. This morning we talked about seeing the unseen. I remember, there's so much there, but in 1993 I was living in Birmingham, Alabama, and it was a beautiful day, March 9th. And I'll never forget, it was so nice out, and it was like 75 degrees, and I walked in the kitchen and I thought, you know, I'm going to make myself a little something to eat, and we had a little television in the kitchen that would come on by itself, and I thought, well, I'm making a sandwich, I'll just turn on the Weather Channel. And you know you're a little bit older when you enjoy the Weather Channel. And this guy was talking, and I heard him, he had these little wire-rimmed glasses, kind of a nerdy-looking guy, and he says, tomorrow it's going to snow in Birmingham, Alabama. And I about choked on my sandwich. I thought, it's 75 degrees out. The next morning we had 16 inches of snow, which it never snows in Alabama anyway, but we had 16 inches of snow. So that guy knew something I didn't know. And when we deal with the Holy Spirit, he sees things we don't see. And I get the revelation he's smarter than we are. And so to listen to the Holy Spirit is a lot going to save you a lot of trouble, a lot of time, and so forth. So we're just going to enjoy the Lord here tonight, and just, I don't preach very long, but it's excellent. And and good to see all of you from Monmouth here again. This guy went to the doctor, and he told his doctor, he said, you know, my wife's hearing's getting bad. It really bothers me. I don't know how to tell her. I don't know how to let her know. And the doctor kind of said, well, why don't you just stand at a good distance from her and just say something and see if she responds. If she doesn't answer, get a little closer. So next day he stands behind her, and he says, about 40 feet away, he said, honey, what's for dinner? No answer. So he gets about 30 feet away. Honey, what's for dinner? No answer. Gets about 20 feet away. No answer. 10 feet away. Honey, what's for dinner? No answer. Finally gets right up behind her, and he said, honey, what's for dinner? And she said, Jack, for the fifth time, we're having chicken. Think it's somebody else's situation. One more. This guy and his wife weren't getting along too good, and so she made him go to a marriage seminar. So there was this weekend, this marriage seminar. He needs help. So the guy's a real good speaker, and he challenged me, and he said, I'm going to tell you, a lot of you men don't even know your wife's favorite flower. And this guy leans down to his wife, and he said, it's gold medal all purpose, isn't it? Yeah, another one. When my wife and I go out to eat, we have a tradition. I always order for her. And it's just a tradition. But the reason I do mainly is because it's so hard for her to yell across the car into the speakerphone. So I order for her. It took her slow. Okay. How many ever heard the scripture, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind? That's from Luke 10:27. We have to love God more than one way. We got to love him four ways. You see this table up here? Do you notice it has four legs? That keeps it up. We drive cars that seem to have four wheels. We need to be in balance. Sometimes say, I love God, but it's not enough just to love God. You got to love him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. Wow. And so, there's so many fours in Scripture. I don't know if you ever notice it, but there's four joys. There's great joy. There's exceeding joy. There's exceedingly great joy. and there's joy unspeakable. There's four faiths in the New Testament. There's great faith, there's strong faith, there's weak faith, there's little faith. There's four levels to walk with God. Ezekiel said, he brought me out ankle deep. Then he took me to the water, touched my knees, and then the water came up to my loins, and then finally it was water that I had to swim in. So how many agree with me? There's a lot of people that walk with God, but they're in ankle deep water. I lived in Alabama for years, you know, but go to the beach quite a bit. It's about 4 hours from Birmingham, and I notice most people, when they go all the way to the beach, most people don't get in the water. They just get ankle deep. I personally don't like to lay on the beach. I just don't like drawing a crowd. But but most people, when they go to the beach, don't get in the water. They just wait. A lot of people are that way in the kingdom of God. They just get ankle deep. But God wants us to go out deeper. In fact, Ezekiel, he says, he finally brought me out to where I couldn't touch the bottom. It was waters in which I had to swim. That's what God wants to do. He wants us to get out there where we have to swim. It's good to feel, you feel refreshed when the water touches your ankles, but you're still in control. But the water gets a little deeper, it hits your knees. I believe that represents a prayer life. And then the water gets a little deeper, it begins to touch your loins. That represents your productivity, your fruitfulness. But then finally God says, I want you to follow me in total trust where your feet can't touch the bottom. You're not in control anymore. You have to let the river take you. There's four levels of growth. 1 Peter 5, he said, but the God of all grace who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you've suffered a little while, he will do four things. 1 Peter 5, verse 10, he will perfect you, he will establish you, he will strengthen you, he will settle you. There's four levels of influence. It says in Acts 1, 8, Jesus said, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, which I believe represents your family, in Judea, which I believe represents your friends, in Samaria, which I believe represents the workplace, and then to all the end of the earth, which represents the world. So there's like four levels of influence. There's four levels of transformation. Moreover, Romans 8, verse 30, whom he predestined, these he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. Four is the number of restoration. Zacchaeus, when it says in, when Jesus spoke to him when he had climbed the tree, it said, Zacchaeus, come down, I'm coming to your house. Zacchaeus stood there, a little stunned, Luke 19:8. He stammered apologetically, Master, I give away half my income to the poor, and if I'm caught cheating, I will pay four times the damages. But the greatest four, I've noticed, is the parable of the sower. It says, concerning the parable of the sower, that, and the interpretation of it, you know, is that the seed, first of all, fell on the wayside. And when the seed fell, it first fell on the wayside, and then the seed fell among in stony places. And then the next seed fell among thorns, and then the seed fell on good ground. I used to think, well, doggone it, I hope I'm good ground. But you know, there's really four battles to deal with. The wayside, to me, represents your first battle is with the enemy. The enemy doesn't want you to be committed. The enemy wants to resist you loving God with your whole heart. This is amazing how this ties with loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. So wayside represents the heart. The seed fell among the wayside. Jesus said, Mark 7, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Mark 6:21, where your treasure is, there's your heart. Mark chapter 7, out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, etc. Romans 10, if you believe in your heart. Mark 11, if you don't doubt in your heart. 2 Corinthians 9, give as you've purposed in your heart. You ever have people that have cirrhosis of the giver? And Hebrews 10 says, you're slow, but you're worth waiting for. That's good. Hebrews 10 says, we draw near to him with a pure heart. 1 Peter 1:22 says, love with a pure heart. Proverbs 14 says, the backslider in heart. It's easy to go through the motions. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will what? How many want your paths directed? Hallelujah. So anyway, our first battle in loving God, because we want to love him with all four ways, is to love God with all your heart. And there's a battle with the enemy because he doesn't want you to give your whole heart. He wants you to do the lip service. He wants you to go through the motions. The second battle is stony ground. It said the seed fell on stony ground. And what I've learned is that the soul, loving, I got to love God with all my soul. How many know that's your emotions? I used to serve God starting out. I'd love him one day and be mad at him the next. Wow. James said, out of the same mouth comes blessing and cursing. It shouldn't be. David said, he restores my soul. So God, you know, he saves our spirit. We become born again. We're going to heaven. But God said, your soul needs some work. It needs some restoring. And so it said the seed fell among stones. Many times people, even though they're saved, they're having trouble loving God with their soul because their soul, even though it's saved, it's full of stones. Stones of bitterness. Stones of harbored offenses. Stones of unforgiveness. Stones of rejection. How many have been there? Bitterness. Maybe stone of pride, maybe a stone of negativity. I think everybody's wounded. I think everybody's had some place where you got wounded and there's stones in your soul, but you've got to love God with those, with that soul. Some pastor talked to a farmer and he said, what a beautiful piece of land you and the Lord have. And the farmer says, yeah, it is. You should have seen it when God had it by himself. In other words, it took some work to get this land like it is. And I want to tell you what happens. We're loving God. God, I love you with my heart. I'm committed to you. And God says, now, will you love me with your soul? Will you love me with your emotions? You've got some rejection issues. Will you let me dig those stones out? Because sometimes when God starts putting his hand on a stone, we use the stone to throw at somebody. Because I want to tell you, some people are so hurt, they're so wounded, that they're going through life with a defensiveness, a posture. Have you ever noticed that some people, you can't get real close to them because they're saying, I've been hurt before, I'm not going to get hurt again. And you feel that. And so to love God, we've got to say, Lord, get the stones out of my heart. Some of the seed has fallen in this stony area of my heart. Hallelujah. I was running into this guy. He visited when I was a pastor. He came to my church. He was kind of a little bit weird, but you know, half the people are. And he says, he just really kind of flaunting himself around, the Lord this, the Lord that. And, you know, I just said, what church do you go to? He said, I'm not the member of any church. I'm a member of the body of Christ. And if I get insulted, usually it takes me 2 or 3 days to realize I've been insulted. And this time, these words came out of me. And I said, that's like saying, I'm not a member of a family, I'm a member of the human race. So it's one thing to be a member of the body of Christ, but it's another thing to have a church family. And so we can't have that independent, maverick spirit. You've all heard this, but my favorite story, anybody ever see the movie Castaway? Tom Hanks has to be a good actor because he kept people's attention for 2 hours by himself. But it reminded me of the story I heard where this guy had been trapped on a desert island, or like an island in the middle of the ocean, I mean. Finally, a ship came by after 5 years, and this guy's beard was way down to here, and captain got off the ship and he said, We're here to rescue. How long have you been here? The guy said, as far as I can tell, I've been here 5 years. And the captain said, well, we're here to help you. And he says, what are these buildings you built? And this guy said, this is a house. This is a house I built. That's where I live, on this island by myself. And what's this other building? And the guy said, well, this is my church. This is where I go to church. And he says, what's this other building? He said, that's the church I used to go to. So there's these... there's these issues we have. And I found something. A lot of people with stones in their soul, they're always going to be a victim. It's always somebody else did this to me. Somebody hurt me. Somebody wounded me. Somebody damaged me. And they go away. And it's sad. If you go to convalescent homes, you'll see people that have been, they've had stones in their soul all their life, and they're still bitter, and they're still full of rage, they're still full of resentment. Wouldn't it be a glory to God if we say, this person just decided not to just love me with all their heart, but also to love me with their soul. God, heal my emotions, because I can be a basket case. Heal my soul. Hallelujah. They say if you want to pastor the largest church in the world, all you have to do is gather up all the spirit-filled, tongue-praying people that are offended that don't go to church anymore. You will pastor the largest church in the world because there's so many offended people out there. They never confront their woundedness. Wow. Almost done here. The seed fell among thorns. Mark 4:18, Jesus said, now these are the ones sown among thorns. They are the ones who hear the word, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire for other things entering and choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. So, thorns are that area where distractions and the cares of this world rob your strength. So, if we're going to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, we're going to get these emotions, then we have to say, God, I refuse to be distracted, because this world will distract you. If you get caught up in the things of the world, nothing against the world, but sometimes people that love God are just distracted. And what it does, it neutralizes your effectiveness, and it gets you doing so many things. And I found if you don't pray early in the day, you won't get much prayer in. You know what I'm saying? It's easy to be distracted. If you don't think you're distracted, just commit your time to prayer. You ever done that? Say, okay, I'm going to pray. I'm going to just sit down and pray for 30 minutes. How many know the first thing that happens is the devil's going to say, you need to wash the car. And you need to sort out the closet and the basement. This would be a good time to work on the basement, because the devil's having a nervous breakdown because you're choosing to get your priorities right and get some fellowship with God.
Amen.
And the devil's saying, wash the car, clean the closet, sort the basement. And God's kind of saying there, well, the car's been that way since 93. You know, why are you going to do it now? You know, in other words, but it's amazing. If you don't believe me, try it. You won't believe. And when I get into prayer, I have to take a notebook, because every thought that could ever happen hits me. I just take a notebook and I write down and say, okay, I'll do that later. Okay, I'll do that later. Okay, I'll do that later. And to get to a place where you can focus without distracting, the seed fell among thorns because it was the cares of the world. And so many people with good intentions, they never get there because they can't love God with all their strength. Believe me, the enemy's out to take your strength by distracting you, that you're using all your energy on something else besides the things of the kingdom. And it's just, the bottom line is, I want to love God all four ways. Wow. You ever tried to drive a car with a flat tire? It's hard to steer. And a lot of us, we run around with a flat tire spiritually. Or a leg missing from the table. I saw an ad, a table in a picture window. It was 25% off sale. It was missing one leg. And the deal is, we got to love God all four ways. Wow. Amazing about the fours. Okay, we get to the fifth one, or the fourth one. This is loving God with all our mind. This is good ground. The seed fell upon good ground. Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the
mind.
If there's any truth worth talking about, it's the fact that if you're going to follow God, you've got to change your mind. You've got to let God be renewed. Jesus, when he first started out, he said, repent and believe the gospel. In other words, repent and change the way you think. Because you cannot be a Christian without changing the way you think. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Romans 12:2. Romans 12:16. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Philippians 4. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true, noble, just, good, pure, lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, thing praiseworthy, meditate on these things. How many know you're not free to let your mind just do what it wants to do? Because I promise you, it'll have a mind of its own. Because loving God with all my mind is saying, I'm not going to let my mind just do anything it wants to do. I'm not free to just let my mind go anywhere it wants to go, but I'm going to love God with this mind. Hallelujah. So again, I'm going to love God with all my heart. I'm going to let my heart be committed to Him. I'm not going to just be into lip service, but I want this heart to belong to God. Secondly, I've been wounded. I've been hurt. I've got some damage in my soul. My emotions have been hurt, but I'm going to let God heal it. I'm going to let Him get every stone, whether it's bitterness, whether it's unforgiveness, whether it's jealousy, whether it's some kind of wound I have. I want Him to pull these things out. Because I guarantee if you don't, you're going to go from church to church. You're going to go from relationship to relationship. Because people that do that, it's because their soul is full of stones. They're still offended. Again, I'm going to love God with all my strength. I'm going to determine not to let my life be distracted by things and stuff. In other words, I'm going to keep my priorities in order. I'm going to love God so that no enemy is able to take my strength. Distracted people. The church has always had two great enemies, and neither one of them have anything to do with the devil. The church's two greatest enemies are self-satisfaction and distraction. I've seen it in 1,000 different ways through my years of ministry. Those, you can break it all down to two. Most people are bound. They're either self-satisfied or they're distracted. And so if you're self-satisfied, God's hands are tied. I love the scripture. And Pastor quoted it this morning, but he said, we got to press through. You got to press through. That woman with the issue of blood, she pressed through. When she finally touched Jesus' clothes, Jesus turned around and said, who touched me? Because the healing didn't have anything to do with him. It had to do with her. And it said she fell down and told him everything. When he said, who touched me? Peter jumped in and said, at first in Luke 8, it said they all denied him. Listen, I've been in church for years. I've never touched him. You know, and it's like, it's like, no, somebody touched me. Because how many people go to church and they don't touch God? And the issue isn't whether God's going to touch you. The issue is whether you're going to touch God. And Peter said, well, we're in a crowd. You know, probably all kinds of people are touching you. People are bumping into you. And I think Jesus told Peter, just go wait in the car. You don't have a clue what I'm talking about. But the deal is, it's not enough to be in the presence of God. Something in you has to say, I'm going to touch Him. I'm not just here to put in time. I'm not just here to go through the motions. I'm going to touch God. The greatest truth God ever gave me is from Isaiah 55 when He says, ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, come and buy. Come and buy. And you always have to have an attitude to buy. I'm here tonight to buy a healing. I'm here tonight to buy some joy. I'm here tonight to buy some direction. I want to buy. Because most people don't buy anything, and they leave the same way they came. You have a Sam's Club here? You ever notice people stand there? If you go around there at noon, if you don't have lunch money, it's a great place because they're handing you trays and stuff. Try it a little bit, pretty soon you feel pretty good. Sometimes I leave and go change clothes, and all of a sudden, but how many know that person holding the tray isn't there to fill you up? They're here to get, try to get you to buy. And we come into God's presence, and God gives us a sample. We think, I got it. No, you didn't. You didn't get him. You just got a sample. God said, I wanted you to taste, so you'll make a purchase, so you'll buy some. So you say, I got to have more of that.
Come on now. Good for you.
Uh-huh.
Wow. Somebody touched me. I think Jesus heard the cash register ring. Somebody took something. Something in you has to say, I'm not going to be here to go through the motions. God, I'm putting a demand on you tonight. I'm going to receive from your hand. I need some direction. I trust you to talk to me. I need some insight. I need some joy. I need a healing. Wow. So let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Colossians 3, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. The best way to love God is with your mind. Again, you don't have the luxury of letting your mind just do what it wants to do. Because believe me, it'll go crazy. It'll go right to the ditch. Wow. So, there's four ways to love God. Let's say it. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. So I hope you're challenged tonight, not to just go through and go, well, I love God. No, you got to love Him in more than one way, or you're going to be driving with three flat tires. Because God wants us to experience Him all. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So let's just lift our hands to the Lord. Lord, we thank you tonight. We praise you. We praise you for your goodness. We praise you for the power of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, for moving in us. And Lord, we do want to determine to buy. We want to be determined to love you with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind. In Jesus' name, we agree. We agree. We agree. Thank you, Lord.